Welcome back to this next video, and in this video we are going to talk about the ubiquitin proteasome system. This ubiquitin proteasome system is very important component of the cell cycle, and it ensures that the cell division and the cell cycle is carried out in a regulated fashion. This ubiquitin proteasome system is a major intracellular protein degradation system in eukaryotes and is thus responsible for homeostasis of proteins at the level of the cell. So the ubiquitin proteasome system is actually a system of homeostasis at the level of a cell. Now the importance of the UPS system, it can be determined by the fact that its male function can lead to several important diseases, including the Alzheimer's disease, the amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, the neuronal degradation, the Parkinson's disease, and the Huntington's disease. Now this UPS system, it can male function in two ways. In one way, it can male function is that it become overzealous. And when the UPS system it become overzealous, it is going to destroy the useful proteins in an inappropriate way. And if the UPS is destroying the useful protein inside the cell, that means that the male function UPS in its overzealous system can badly damage the cells. Another way in which the UPS can male function is then when its function become restrained. By that I mean that in the restrained form, the UPS system, it cannot degrade the proteins in the cell. And when the UPS cannot degrade the harmful proteins in the cell, the harmful proteins, they build up to the toxic level. And in most of the diseases, it is this restrained form of the UPS that is there. And because of the restrained nature of the UPS, the harmful proteins, they build up to the toxic level in the cell, causing disease in the human beings. Now, in different diseases, the impact of the UPS, it is maybe it may be related to the deficits in the clearance of the misfolded proteins. That means that if it is not able to clear the misfolded protein, it is in the restrained form, and when the misfolded proteins they are not cleared, they are going to lead to intracellular protein aggregation, cytotoxicity, and the cell death. What this means is that you need a fully functional and regulated UPS system for the normal functioning of the cells. If you talk about the human cells, there are thousands of proteins in any cell at any one time. So the job of the UPS to keep them under control is a tough one. That means that the that the UPS system have to identify only those particular proteins which are not needed for the cell at that particular time, and to degrade them, and not to degrade those particular proteins that are present in the cell at that particular time which the cell needs. So the job of the UPS, it is a tough one. Now the UPS, it achieves its target by a mechanism known as the ubiquitination. So the UPS system is doing its job by the mechanism of the ubiquitination. Now, what is the mechanism of the ubiquitination? Now, ubiquitination is the addition of a small protein, that particular protein is known as ubiquitin, to the target protein which needs to be degraded. That means that if you are going to degrade a protein, you have to attach this particular ubiquitin protein to it. And when a ubiquitin protein is attached to the target protein, that particular protein is given a visible death sentence. So ubiquitination is simply the attachment of the ubiquitin to the target protein which need to be degraded. Now what is this ubiquitin protein? This ubiquitin protein is a small protein. It is only made up of 76 amino acids. Its molecular weight is 8.6 carol dalton, and it's a regulatory protein found in most tissue of the eukaryotic organism. Now, it is called ubiquitin because it is found ubiquitously. That means it is existing everywhere, especially at the same time, and it is found in a very large amount in all of the eukaryotic cell. Now, how this UPS system actually works, let us discuss that in a little bit detail. Now, the ubiquitin protein, it cannot attach itself to protein until it is activated. I've told you that when the ubiquitin that is attached to the target protein by the process of the ubiquitination, that particular protein, they are degraded, but the things, they are not this much simple. So how this UPS system actually works, it requires the function of a different kind of the enzymes, and the different kind of the enzyme actually leads to the addition of the ubiquitin to the target protein, which is later on degraded. Now, the first enzyme that is required in this particular pathway is known as the E1 activating enzyme, which required an ATP molecule. Now, how this E1 activating enzyme work? Now, the E1, it is going to activate ubiquitin, and in this particular mechanism, the active site cysteine residue of the E1, this is the E1 enzyme, and in the active site of the E1, there is a cysteine amino acid. So the cysteine amino acid of the E1 that is going to attack on the C-terminal glycine of the ubiquitin protein. So the cysteine of the E1 that is going to interact with the glycine, which is present at the C-terminal of the ubiquitin, utilizing an ATP molecule. So when the E1 utilizes an ATP molecule and it attacks on the glycine of the ubiquitin, the end result is that the ubiquitin that is attached to the E1 enzyme. So you can see over here, when you interact the E1 and the ubiquitin in the presence of the ATP, you are going to get a complex of the ubiquitin cysteine E1. And this particular mechanism, as I've told you, it uses ATP as a source of energy. So the cysteine of the E1 and the glycine of the ubiquitin, they are interacting with each other, and the ubiquitin is now attached to the E1. Now, when the E1, it activates the ubiquitin molecule, what happens is that the activated ubiquitin that is transferred from the E1 to the E2 enzyme. And you can see over here that the activated ubiquitin that have been transferred to the E2 of the, and that the that has been transferred to the E2 protein. Now, what happens is that there is also an cysteine amino acid in the active site of the E2. Now, this arrow should be in this particular direction. So there is a cysteine amino acid in the active site of the E2, and the ubiquitin is attached to the cysteine amino acid, which is also in the active site of the E1. So the activated ubiquitin, it is transferred from this cysteine, from the cysteine of the E1, to the cysteine of the E2. Now, this E2 is known as the ubiquitin conjugating enzyme. And in this particular mechanism, the ubiquitin, which is activated by the E1, is then transferred to the E2, where it interacts with the cysteine of the E2, which is present in the active site of the E2 enzyme. The third enzyme, which is present in this particular pathway, is known as the ubiquitin ligase or the E3 ligase enzyme. Now, this E3 ligase enzyme, it acts like a platform on which the active ubiquitin, which has been activated by the E1 and has been transferred to the E2, and the target protein, they meet and they interact with each other. If you can see over here, that the activated ubiquitin that has been attached to the E2, and there is the substrate protein. Now the substrate protein and the E2, they come in contact with each other with the help of this E3 ligase or the ubiquitin ligase enzyme. So the E3 is actually providing a platform for the interaction of the E2 and the substrate protein. Now this activated ubiquitin, which is now attached on the E2 and have interacted with the E3, so this ubiquitin is transferred to the lysine residue on the target protein. So the ubiquitin, which is interacting with the cysteine of the E2, with the help of the E3, is now transferred to the substrate protein, and in the substrate protein it is going to interact with the lysine residues. The carboxy terminal of the glycine of the ubiquitin, that is going to interact with the amino terminal of the lysine of the target protein. Now this particular mechanism is repeated several times, and several E2, they are going to add substrate, they are going to add ubiquitin to the substrate protein, thereby adding a polyubiquitin tail to the substrate protein. And this particular phenomena in which you add a polyubiquitin tail to the substrate protein is known as polyubiquitination. Now, if I summarize the whole process, as you can see over here, the cysteine amino acid in the active site of the E1, it interacts with the glycine of the ubiquitin with the help of the ATP, and the ubiquitin, it's get activated. Now, the activated ubiquitin is transferred from the cysteine of the E1 to the cysteine of the E2, thereby the ubiquitin is transferred to the E2 enzyme. Now the E2 enzyme, that is going to interact with the E3 ligase, and the E3 ligase is also interacting with the substrate. So with the help of the E3, the activated ubiquitin is transferred from the E2 into the substrate protein, and when this process is repeated several times, several activated ubiquitin proteins have been attached to the substrate protein, and this particular phenomena is known as the polyubiquitination, in which you add multiple ubiquitin to the substrate protein. Now you have tagged the protein for degradation by the addition of this polyubiquitin tail. Now it's time for the degradation of the protein. So how the proteins, they are degraded? Now the target protein, after polyubiquitination, it leaves the E3 ligase, and when it leaves the E3 ligase, it is then degraded by the cell waste disposal unit, which is known as the proteasome. Now this proteasome is actually a complex of the proteases, and these proteases are going to cleave the peptide bonds in the target protein, which you are going to degrade. Now the proteasome, which is used in mammals, is usually known as a 26S proteasome, and its molecular weight is about 2000 kilodalton. And this proteasome is actually a cylindrical complex containing a four stacked ring structure. Now each ring is composed of seven individual proteins. Each of these four rings, each ring is going to have seven individual proteins. Now these four stacked rings, that can be divided into two separate rings, the inner rings and the outer rings. Now the inner two rings, they are made up of seven beta subunits, and the interior or the inner ring of the proteasome contain the active site of the proteases, and hence the inner rings are responsible for degradation of the protein. Now the function of the outer ring, which is made up of the alpha subunit, is to recognize the polyubiquitin tags which are attached to the protein substrate and initiate the degradation process. Simply put, the polyubiquitin tail of the which is attached to the target protein is recognized by the outer ring of the proteasome, and then it is pushed into the inner side of the ring, and at the inner rings of the proteasome where the proteins, they are degraded. If you look at this one, this is the target protein. This is the polyubiquitin tail attached to it. So when this target protein and the polyubiquitin tail, this the outer rings, they are going to recognize this polyubiquitin tail, thereby inserting this target protein into the inner rings of the proteasome. And if you can see over here, once the polyubiquitin tail that have helped the proteasome in the identification of the target protein, the polyubiquitin tail have been converted into the individual ubiquitin proteins, which are reused by the cell. And when the proteins, the whole of the protein, when it moves through the inner rings of the proteasome, it has been converted into the individual amino acid or short peptides, which can be used by the cell for the synthesis of new proteins. So this is how the ubiquitin proteasome system that works. If you talk about the numbers of the different enzymes that are used in the UPS system, so there are only two types of the even activating enzyme. There are about 60 different types of the E2 ubiquitin conjugating enzymes, and there are about 600 to 800 ubiquitin ligase or E3 ligase enzyme. Now the reason for the different number of numbers of different enzyme is that if you talk about the even activating enzyme, it have got a very general function, that is to activate a ubiquitin protein. Therefore, their number is very low, their different types are very low in the cell. If you talk about the E2 ubiquitin conjugating enzyme, there are 60 different types, a very much higher number than the E1. The reason is that the E3, that is very choosy in interacting with the E2 ubiquitin ligase. The ubiquitin ligase, the number of the enzyme, the number of different types of the E3 ligase is very high because there are different kind of the proteins in the cell. There are phosphorylated proteins, there are glycosylated proteins, there are acetylated proteins. That means that if there are different types of the protein in the cell, and if you want to degrade them, you need a different, a very large number of the E3 ligase enzyme. Therefore, in the mammalian cells, the number of E3 ligase enzyme is very high. The E2 conjugating enzyme is low as compared to the E3, and the E1, they are low as compared to the E2 and the E3 as well.